الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على المبعوث رحمة للعالمين نبينا محمد وعلى آله وأصحابه أجمعين. All praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, creator of entire creation. Complete blessings and salutations be upon the masterpiece Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam and all his companions and those who have followed and shall follow. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us also from amongst them. Honored ulama, beloved brothers and sisters and dearest listeners, tonight we commenced the recitation of Surah An-Nisa, a very, very important surah because it deals with the women folk. It is named after the women. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions in it certain regulations and rules and highlights certain issues that are very, very close to the hearts of the women. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make them close to all of our hearts. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts the surah in a very, very interesting way. He begins it by telling us how he created women.
Ya ayyuha an-nas ittaqoo rabbakum alladhi khalaqakum min nafsin wahidah wa khalaqa minha zawjaha wa batha minhuma rijalan kathiran wa nisaa.
O people, look at this, the address is not just for the believers. O people, be conscious of your Rabb, of your Creator, who has created you from one man. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala had to speak about Adam alayhi salatu wasalam, because through him the woman was created. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, be conscious of your Creator who created you from a single being, from a single soul, from one human, that is Adam alayhi salatu wasalam. And from him, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created the woman. So it is the duty of the men folk to look after the women. Adam alayhi salatu wasalam was alone at one stage. He made a dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Ya Allah, I am the only one of my species. I am lonely. Take away this loneliness. He continued making that dua until one day Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave him a gift in the form of a woman. So a woman is to be treated as a gift to a man. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us that understanding. And over and above that, the women are meant to be handling themselves in a manner that they prove that they are actually gifts to the men. Sometimes the way they handle themselves, they become a burden. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect our women folk so that they are not like that. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us firstly how he created the woman. And he makes it clear that look, a woman was actually a gift. And a woman was created from the rib of man so that man should protect this woman. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us the ability to do that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala speaks about something very interesting again. He warns us all and he says, be conscious of your Creator and be conscious of the womb that gave birth to you. That means be conscious of the women folk as well and all your relations, those who are related to you through the wombs of the women. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says,
وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ.
Be mindful of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Be conscious of Him. That is the Allah whom you seek items by. Don't we use the name of Allah when we want certain things sometimes? We use Wallahi, we promise, meaning we make oaths and so on. And Allah says, and be conscious of the women folk, be conscious of your relations through the wombs, because each one of us was given birth to. But we come oblivious of the status of our own mothers at times. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala not do that to us. We are meant to understand that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose mothers for us. We should fulfill the rights of those mothers at all times. And we must understand their value. The one who loses track of the value of women folk and the value of their own parents, his or her own parents, that person is a loser. So here Allah is drawing our attention to that. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off mentioning one of the most important things, close to a woman. How many women have been cheated out of their wealth, especially after someone has passed away? The wealth of inheritance, and the men folk come along and they deceive her, they cheat her, they undervalue, they don't want to give her. They tell her, you have been given in the lifetime of our father. Now that our father's dead, you have nothing here. Go away and get from your husband. Allah mentions that here.
وآتوا اليتامى أموالهم ولا تتبدلوا الخبيث بالطيب.
Give the orphan child his or her due, more so the female child. And Allah speaks about the helpless child, the orphan child. Allah says, don't change their good wealth with your bad wealth. Sometimes you find an orphan child might have some belongings, and we tend to replace those belongings because we feel this child doesn't really know much, undervaluing items that we are meant to be giving these children. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala starts off with that. I'm sure the women folk would have a smile on their faces to say, look in Surah An-Nisa, the opening verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is saying, don't cheat me when it comes to wealth. Don't cheat me when it comes to inheritance. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala protect us. One might say that, well, this is speaking about the orphan child, and here you are saying that it's referring to the women. More so, it refers to those young girls who are more cheated than anyone else. The most vulnerable is mentioned in these verses. But it obviously includes every single person. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us from amongst those who can uplift this deen. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentions another very interesting ruling. Very interesting ruling. What is going on today in the world? Let's be honest. Let's be fair. Many people are engaged in affairs, sexual affairs, extramarital affairs. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows how He has created a man, and He knows how He has created a woman. So here Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is making mention of what is to be given preference over affairs. Firstly, if you like someone, marry them. Get married to them. Propose, and when the proposal is accepted, alhamdulillah, nikah is made so easy. There is no excuse to commit zina. But if the proposal is rejected, go away. Try elsewhere. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala grant us understanding. Also, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made nikah so easy, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has addressed parents through Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, saying that when someone comes to you proposing for your child, do not reject it without a valid reason. Sometimes we reject it just because I had a fight with the father of that man, or I had a fight with the father of that woman, and so on. So I don't want my daughter or my son to go into that house, so I say over my dead body. May Allah protect us. Those statements are un-Islamic. If there is an Islamic reason for your rejection and refusal, alhamdulillah. If not, make it easy for the people to marry, because if you don't do that, you will be encouraging zina. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala safeguard us. Then Allah speaks about those who are married. If they happen to incline and they still would like to marry more, and remember here, we are neither encouraging it nor are we discouraging it. We are just making mention of a permissibility which is in the Quran. So please make sure that we understand. I am neither encouraging it nor discouraging it. I am making mention of a verse in the Quran. It's not my ruling, it's not your ruling, it's the ruling of Allah, Rabbul Izzati wal Jalal. Sometimes we are guilty of preferring haram over halal, and we don't even want to give halal a chance. And sometimes the men folk are guilty of secretly engaging in certain relationships in a manner that then they use Islam to halalize, if I can use that word. They use Islam to halalize their illicit relationships. That is also wrong. But here, if a person would like to do it, Allah says, come out clear. Speak to the people. Be open about it. And He says, فَانْكِحُوا مَا طَابَ لَكُم مِّنَ النِّسَاءِ مَثْنَى وَثُلَاثَ وَرُبَاعَ فَإِنْ خِفْتُمْ أَلَّا تَعْدِلُوا فَوَاحِدَةً أَوْ مَا مَلَكَتْ أَيْمَانُكُمْ. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, if you really want to, you may marry two, three, or four. And it is not barbaric. What is barbaric is when you have mistresses up to 20 and 30, and that is the norm in the Western world. May Allah protect us all. And may Allah make us from amongst those who can uplift His deen. And now we shouldn't go home tonight and use this verse to say, you know what, I'm getting another wife. We were told in the masjid that we are allowed. No, Allah says, if you have reason to do so and you are going to be just and you are doing it for the correct reasons, then you may do so, bearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in mind, giving this halal relationship preference over that which is haram and illicit. Then you will be termed a gentleman and you will be termed a good Muslim. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it easy for our women folk to digest this more than the men folk. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make the men folk from amongst those who will understand that there is a huge responsibility. It's not just a pastime, and it's not just something you can have fun about. Go and ask those who have more than one wife. They will tell you, brother, stay away from it. May Allah protect us. So this is the ruling that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept in the Quran, and we must understand it.